Alcatraz's reputation as an escape-proof prison was reinforced by the legend that it was surrounded by shark-infested waters. In the past century, there have been 120 recorded shark attacks off the California coast. 11 people have been killed. The concentration of sharks here is so dense that scientists have defined a danger zone known as the Red Triangle. San Francisco Bay is at the center.
There are many sharks in San Francisco Bay. Depending on the time of year, you could find over a dozen different species that may be in the area.
The largest living in the bay is the broad-nosed seven-gill. They hunt in packs, using stealth and deception to attack their prey.
The females can probably reach about 3 or 3.5 meters and be several hundred pounds.
Shark attacks aren't common, but they do hunt at night. Could the three fugitives of 1962 have been torn apart in a feeding frenzy?
Most of the sharks that would be around Alcatraz probably would have been toward the bottom, which can be upwards of 10 to 20 meters, depending on where you're at around the island. So that fact alone means that they probably didn't encounter anything.
Instead, experts think the fear of shark attacks owes more to human myth-making than ferocious ocean predators.
I think the whole shark-infested waters just is something that endures in the human psyche. San Francisco is certainly part of that. The ocean kind of represents the unknown to a lot of people, and then throw in this predator that still exists that people misunderstand. When you say shark, for some reason, it really gets some ancient primitive reaction out of people where they all logic kind of goes out the window and they're just afraid that there's this monster in the water and it's going to eat them.
But if the men had drowned in the bay, sharks and other creatures may have helped hide their remains.
If they did sink to the bottom, there are numerous other species in the bay. Anything, really, that would have encountered a decomposing body would have scavenged on it. Tons of different invertebrates, smaller sharks, and other just plain fish that would seize the opportunity. Nobody would have found it.
The men may have drowned and been eaten by scavengers, but they may have made it to dry land. And so the FBI hunt continued.
There's always that possibility that they did make it.
Despite reports of a body being sighted in the water, it's possible at least two of the escapees made it to the mainland. That leaves another big question unanswered.
You would think that if they did make it to shore, three men dressed as prisoners would have been noticed, especially after an alarm had been raised.
But no one was looking for them. The alarm wasn't raised until 7:15 a.m. the following morning. The prisoners' intricate escape plan ensured that the guards wouldn't notice they were missing.
They came up with another great idea, to go ahead and make these dummy heads to make it look like they were sleeping in bed. Two of them were made out of plaster, I believe. The third one was made out of soap and rags. Now, they were allowed to have artwork and paints, so they used flesh-colored paint, and they actually were able to get hair from the barbershop to put on the heads to make it look like an actual human being here.
The heads may have been crudely made, but the prisoners' attention to detail ensured they were lifelike enough to deceive the guards.
These guys were just so ingenious. If you look at the models of their heads that they made, they're so realistic, it's creepy.
The deception gave the missing men a 7-hour head start on their pursuers. And 7 hours can take you a long way from San Francisco. Officially, of course, the authorities stick to their story. The men most likely drowned in the bay. But behind the scenes, the investigation was still very much alive.
They never came up with any bodies in San Francisco Bay. So there's always a possibility that they could have made it. And you you can see how complex this type of investigation is. There's volumes and volumes of paperwork here.
In the months following the escape, there were reported sightings all over the states.
The FBI investigation was really impressive, very thorough. They followed up on every lead, no matter how trivial it sounds. For instance, they interviewed the girlfriends of the inmates because a cellmate had told the police that a girlfriend was going to meet them on land and drive them to Mexico. In another instance, an eyewitness believes they've seen him sending a letter in a post office. They go to Alaska because an eyewitness has reported they've seen them living on a farm.
Declassified memos which mention the fugitives reveal that one destination in particular was of interest to the FBI.
Even back in 1964 and 1965, they were investigating leads in Rio de Janeiro, which falls in line with exactly what we're looking at today for the leads we have on Rio de Janeiro area.
Rio de Janeiro is a tropical city on the Atlantic Ocean, synonymous with exotic beaches, the tanned, and the beautiful. But in 1962, Brazil is dangerously unstable. Bitter political disputes lead to a military coup.
Brazil was kind of a free-for-all during that period with a lot of political turmoil. I doubt the authorities would have made a very high priority of keeping a lookout for a couple of escaped American convicts.
Brazil is the fifth largest country in the world. In 1962, its population of 77 million included a large European and American community.
Everyone's coming after you. You're not going to stay in the United States. So if you want to disappear, this is the place to go.